shout if you want anything explained again, or if I go too fast, or if I quieten down and you can't hear me, okay? I can't do anything about the accent, but you can just be able to tune in, hopefully. So I'm James Watson, not the James Watson. So if you're expecting DNA and the discovery of it, I'm sorry to disappoint you. I was a researcher at EBI, and then I became a scientific training officer, so kind of doing organised workshops and roadshows, and occasionally like this one, who I train on. Yesterday you were supposed to have this very short introduction to other bits and pieces of the EBI, which Jana managed to do, so I'm going to do it very quickly today because there is enough time in the programme to fit this in and to start the Array Express thing in the morning. So, just to give you an overview of what we are and who we are. So the EBI is based at the Wellcome Trust campus near Cambridge in the UK. We're part of a European organisation called EBL, and we are a non-profit organisation. So everything we produce is freely accessible. EBL has five main branches. The headquarters are in Heidelberg, which is where all the administration and all the basic research labs are based. But there are two additional structural biology outstations, one in Hamburg and one in Monte Rotondo. One in Grenoble. The Monte Rotondo site is for mouse biology research, and Hingston is bioinformatics. So EMBL is made up of a lot of European member states. They all joined at various different times, and we have a recent associate member state of Australia, so we're branching out. Australia is not really in Europe, but they're part of EMBL. And EMBL, most of its funding comes from these member states, but we also get a variety of other grants from the EU, the Wellcome Trust, the NIH in the States, and various UK research grants as well. So it's quite a collection of money that goes into funding this. Now you're all probably getting aware of what bioinformatics is, but fundamentally we're all about storing, retrieving and analysing data. And it's very, very interdisciplinary now, and the heart of just about most aspects of modern biology. So as a result of this, there's a massive increase in data. So if you look at any of these charts about the data storage, basically it hits mid to late 2000s, and then everything just grows exponentially. Now, the vast majority of this is through the high throughput technologies that have come online, but also the growth and spread of different types of applied biology. So we're storing a lot of the data now. And this type of information is quite varied. There's all different aspects of it. Proteins, small molecules, DNA, RNA, and everything in between. So all of the stuff that we look at, it goes through all of these areas of biology. So going from all the way from the genome to transcripts to translated products, three-dimensional proteins, small molecules, and pathways and reactions. So all of this stuff we have to store, it's all very diverse and it's very complicated. So the main reason why we do all this is that there's a wide variety of examples. Why we store all this information. Now you'll be very aware of a lot of these, so things like looking at crops, crop plant improvements, looking at specific human diseases, for example cancer, looking at infectious diseases and how the infection happens, possible ways to treat it, how things are transmitted, and looking towards things like the Barcode of Life initiative, so basically barcoding every single organism on the planet. So you can identify endangered species, sustain resources, and also for things like food labeling, so you know exactly which thing is on your plate, basically. and we're also looking into things like medicines and repurposing drugs. So drugs that have been developed for one disease disorder can sometimes be looked at again later on and be used to treat other diseases or other disorders with some minor modifications. so you can go back and reanalyze all of this information. So like I said, as a result of all these different, quite complex requirements, there's a lot of AI data there, and we store information in all these different areas. So we're probably the world's most diverse and complex biological data provider. Now, EBI's basic mission is to provide all of this information freely available, and also to provide services and tools that researchers can use to analyse the data. We also do our own research, so we have various research groups, and we also are involved in training bioinformatics. So it involves events like this, where we go out to various communities and do some training. But we also organise courses in-house, and we have a PhD programme, so we're involved in training students as well. We also have a very close relationship with industry. There is an industry programme where various members pay into, and they have their own training requirements, and they have their own quarterly meetings where they can get together with the researchers and the data to try and work out ways that help both sides. So we get information from them of what they're trying to do, and they get to influence how we set up the data to improve their work. And this is a recent addition to our mission statement, which is to coordinate provision across Europe. So we're now involved in lots of European-wide projects that are there to try and maintain the data for future generations. So the services at EBI, all of them have to have some five key aspects. So they all have to be accessible, so they all have to be openly available. They have to be as compatible as possible with different systems, different processes, and they also have to be able to you should be able to cross-reference the information as well. It has to be as fully comprehensive as possible, so we try and get as much of the information as we can. That information has to be of high quality, so a lot of the information, although not all of it, is manually annotated to try and provide the best possible information. And it has to be extremely portable as well. You need to be able to take it away, bring it in-house, do what you wish with it. So, just as a quick glance, all these different areas that I mentioned earlier, we have major resources in each of those. And they also interact with other resources around the world. So we're not isolated in any way. For example, AliExpress and Geo work together very well. So this idea of database collaborations is shown here. So in Ensemble is a joint EBI Sanger Centre project, but we also have collaborations with people across the world providing information to there. And all of this wouldn't be possible without standards. And there are a number of major ontologies and standardisation aspects for each of these different areas. So for example, in the protein sequence world, UniProt is the major protein sequence provider, and they have come up with a variety of standards for how that information is stored and shared. So, very roughly, this is how these things fall into. You'll see that some of these categories appear in multiple, some of these resources appear across multiple categories. But the main point about this was to note that the ones that I've highlighted in green here are EBI specific resources. So they were developed by us at EBI, and they're ours, so to speak. Okay? However, I mentioned earlier that we're involved in lots of interactions and collaborations. So a lot of the resources are actually collaborative resources. So the PDB is a joint venture now, it's the worldwide PDB, so it's the RCSP in the States, the Japanese Structural Data Bank, and the PDB in Europe, which used to be the Macromolecular Structures Database. So they're all working together now, sharing data, rather than trying to compete on who has the most deposits. It's much better to share your information and try to compete on how you display and how you access that information than it is to try and say who's got the most. Okay. And then finally, these three in purple are ones that were not developed by us or for us in particular, but we provide another interface to. And in particular, I'd like to draw your attention to Blast and Fastday. And if you go to our Blast and Fastday site, if you're ever using it, you'll find that the output of the Blast results are a bit more useful. But I can show that at the end, because there's space at the end of the day. But we'll come to that later. Okay. So, not only that, there's a lot of work going on at EBI at the moment to try and just to improve the site and make it easier for people to find things. And one of the things that they've developed is a new search service. Now, this is targeted more at biologists rather than bioinformaticians. And the whole idea is that you get a nice little interface to all of the data. So if you type a search term into the bar on the homepage, if the gene has been well described, then you will come to one of these pages where it has little tabs that gives you information about all of that. Other than that, it will just search across all of the EBI website for the terms that you put into here. So I suppose it's like a Google search for the site. So data is organized according to the major themes of the information of the site. So gene expression data, protein structure data, and literature. Like I said, this is relevant to wet lab biologists. The information is organized around a gene, very gene-centric, but it doesn't provide any programmatic access. So it's very much, it's not really designed by bioinformaticians as such. So just very quickly to go through some of these major categories, just to point out the databases that maybe are most relevant. Now you had an ensemble session yesterday, so I won't discuss about this in any depth. So we've mentioned the Ensemble Genomes Project as well. So even if you're not working on a chordate, then your species may be in one of these other Ensemble Genomes sites. Now I mentioned earlier that the European Nucleotide Archive is for all nucleotide data. So in there is the full ENA annotated sequences. So it has all of the genes, the transcripts, everything mapped on. There's also assembly information there, so you can actually go back from this to find out, okay, how was this assembly constructed? And you can take it even further by going down to the individual genes themselves, so all of this information is stored. So it takes all of the stuff from what was previously EmboBank and the European Trace Archive, combines it all together in this new database. And information transfers between each of these steps as people complete various projects, start to build assemblies, and then annotate on top of that. But you never delete information out of it, so it's always possible to go back if after X amount of time it's decided that actually there was a mistake in the assembly. You can go all the way back to the start and rebuild. So BioExpress will come on to shortly, and that's basically transcripts, gene expression information. So there's all kinds of search tools there. The Atlas is very much a gene-centric project, but you'll hear about that shortly. Now, Uniprot is the protein sequence database, and there are lots of bits of information that go into Uniprot. So it's not just the protein sequence, it also takes information from Go, Pride, Interpro, Intact, Intens, HAMAP, Visit. So transmit modifications, interactions, functional information, all of that gets brought in. There's a lot of manual curation. There are two types of data in there. There are the kind of former Swiss Prot entries, which are the highly manually curated data. And then there is the Trimble entries, which are the automated annotated data. So if you're ever in Uniprot, look for gold starred entries, because those are the ones that are highly curated. Silver stars mean that it's automatically annotated, so you have to be very wary about using that information. So there's all kinds of other classifications and predictions that go into it as well. Now, one of the projects I think that spawned from that one originally was Interpro. And it came about because there's lots of different databases of protein sequence motifs, patterns, profiles, ways to classify proteins. And what Interpro does is bring all of those together in one place. So you only have to do one search and then you find links to all of these different types of patterns and profiles. So it lets you view the different architectures. So in this case, you've got a domain that has one particular function, and in a particular set of proteins that's associated with these others. However, in this set of proteins, it's only that domain. So it lets you see how things build up into multi-domain proteins. We also have a variety of tools for proteomics. So if you're working on molecular interactions, small molecules, protein identifications from mass spec, enzymes, and clearly as a small molecule. I realise that EBI has a different meaning here, isn't it? It's shrimp, EBI. Yeah, we're nothing to do with shrimp. So the protein data bank, the structures, there's not just, we don't just store the structures, but we also provide a lot of information about that, so the ligands to bind, how these things form multimeric assemblies, the biological state, or the most likely biological state of the protein. You can compare folds with one another and identify similar proteins. So a lot of this, a lot of these tools are there if you're interested in using them. So for chemogenomics, we have the Chembo database. Now, Chembo was data that was bought effectively by the Wellcome Trust and made publicly available from a pharmaceutical company. So all of the bioactive data was turned into this Chembo database, and it lets you browse various targets, do compound searches on the database as well. There's also a neglected tropical disease archive which feeds into this, and if you're interested in kinase, there's a kinase specific site and tool that lets you explore kinases and possible drug targets for them. And they've also just recently set up a GPCR Safari as well. So you can see there's a focus for particular types of protein as well. Reactome, which we'll come across this afternoon, is a pathways database, and it gives you not just pathways, but lets you map other information on. So you can overlay interactions, you can view expression profiles mapped onto the reactions and pathways. And it links out to a lot of variety of other information as well. And you can also export your pathway if you're involved in pathway modelling in any way. It provides a way of getting that information out of the reactome and into the tool that you prefer to use. So, this slide basically says there is a massive amount of information out there that we look after. As a result, we have a lot of web requests, and there's a massive amount of hardware requirements behind this as well. So we're now at the stage of having multiple data centres in different locations, as well as the shared data centre that's on site. So there's lots of ways to get help. You can email by just emailing the support site or going to the support website. Lots of help pages. There are there is an e-learning portal that was just released on Friday that we just learned. It's a train online. If anyone wants to see that, I can show that at the end. But that's a variety of small training courses that are freely available online for specific tools. And as time goes on, we will add more and more resources onto that. So, remember I said one of the key missions of EBI was research. There are 8 dedicated research groups. A lot of the service teams also have a R&D aspect to them, so it's not as if the service teams are completely isolated from the research teams. They work together, and that's what makes the tools that we have more accessible. So this is just the major group leaders that are involved in the research aspects of the EBI. There are a whole host of other group leaders that are involved in the service side as well. And the symbols here just indicate that they're back with their original background. So, for example, Janet Thornton's original background is actually physics. She was involved in protein structures very early on. So you can see it's not just a biology or a bioinformatics background, it comes from quite a wide variety of backgrounds. And I also just wanted to quickly mention training. So like I said, there are training courses at EBI, there's training that goes out to different sites like this, but there's also this train online that's happening. And that's exactly the same information. And we also have PhD program and postdoc training program. There are lots of short-term training opportunities as well, as well as placements and internships and stuff as well. But all of the information is on the EBI website. So the final bit about this is really all of the stuff that we provide, there's no point in making it unless people are going to use it. And you can't make something that people will use unless you know what they're working on. So what would be very useful to us is if you have a think about the rest of the day, think about the types of questions you have, what it is you want to know, and if you could write some of that down, or email it to me, or put it into the survey at the end of the course today, that would be good. Because all of this stuff then goes back to our usability design teams, and they can then make suggestions to the teams to improve either the functionality of a page, or perhaps suggest one database should cross-link to another, because the types of questions people are asking mean that it would be much easier if you just simply had a link here from this to this. So have a think, and any questions that you have that are problems that you're working on would be greatly appreciated. So this section effectively comes in two halves. There's the Array Express warehouse, and then there's the Gene Expression Atlas. And how we're going to work this is, I'll start by explaining the Array Express warehouse, and then there's an exercise on that. Now, that could take us up to, the talk should just take us up to about 10:15, something like that, and then the exercise itself will give you time to do before tea break and a little bit after, and we can then go over the answers and how to find those. But the first exercise should be relatively quick, it's just exploring the warehouse. The Gene Expression Atlas session will then start after the tea break, and there's a short discussion about what's in the atlas, how it's set up, and then there are two exercises on using the atlas, doing searches in the atlas. Okay. So, all of the materials on the Express and the Gene Expression Atlas were provided by Gabriella Stici, who's the trainer from the functional genomics team at EBI, and who very kindly provided me over slides and exercises. So, this is a very rough idea of what we're going to go on about, why we need the database in the first place, what the React Express is, some of the content, how to create it, how to download information, how to submit information to it. So, who works on functional genomics? So, a lot of some of you will recognize the fact that for any functional genomics experiment, there are a lot of steps considered. So, you've got your sample, you've got to collect your sample, treat it, you've also got to put onto an array. You've then got to image it, take the raw data, normalize it, and then perform data analysis. It's the same here, but with the kind of chip-seq data as well. It's just got the additional sections that are specific to that technology. Now, if you were to take anybody's experiment and you wanted to check the results, you would need to know exactly the sample source they used, how they treated it, the protocols they used to get the RNA out, how they labeled it, which technology they used for the arrays, where they put everything, the hybridization protocols, which scanning protocols they used to look at the images, the software they used, all the software specifications for normalization of the data and the statistics that they used and the methods that they used there. So there's a lot of information for you to even just replicate somebody's work. And when the technologies were coming online, that information really wasn't stored. What you would do is you would do your experiment, you write a paper, and you say, we have found this, here is this information, and you provide a couple of choice images, perhaps, if you were lucky, and to justify why you have made these conclusions from this data. You didn't have to put the information anywhere. That information could then be lost when people change groups, when people erase hard drives, all of that stuff. So it became clear very quickly that they needed a database to store all of this information, even if only so that people could check what others are doing. So ArrayExpress is one of the publicly available repositories for functional genomics data, mostly using microarray or high-throughput sequencing, but there are other bits of information in there. We work together with Geo and Scibix to at least support each other and be able to transfer information between each other so that everybody has access to all of the information that they need. It's easily accessible, well-annotated data. It's a standardized format, which makes life a lot easier when you're jumping between different sites. You can now share the information, you can share designs with other groups as well, because by putting that information in detail, other people could then take it and say, oh, that's an interesting way of doing that, solving that problem. I might try that in my lab and see how it works. And as a result, there are a lot of standards have been developed specifically within this technology. For there's a Miami checklist, a different type of format, and there's its own specific ontology as well. Recently, the high throughput sequencing data has been developing a minimum set of requirements for high-throughput sequencing data, so I'll tell you that in a second. So, the first major thing that we came up with was the Miami checklist. Now, this is the minimum information needed about a microarray experiment. And there are various components to it, but the six most critical elements are the sample annotation has to be good, the experimental design information, including the sample data relationships, i.e. which bit of raw data corresponds to which sample, has to also be present. There has to be sufficient array annotation, so probe sequences, gene identifiers, all of that information needs to be there. The protocols used in the lab and in the statistics also have to be stored, or at least declared. The raw data should be available, and also the final normalized data should be available. So the best well-annotated experiments have information in all six of these areas. And if you meet all six of these requirements, then you have the best Miami compliant data. Now for the sequencing side, for the high throughput sequencing, it's very similar, but this is still work in progress. They're still trying to come up agree on exactly the final standards that require, but it's very similar. The experimental design, the annotation, the raw data, the protocols, final process data. All things you would expect to be able to know from anybody who's published in the field. So when we were designing the database and designing how people would be able to provide information to them, they came up with a simple spreadsheet formula called MageTam. And it's a single file that captures all of this information. So there are a variety of different aspects to it, involving the born process files, the sample data relationship file format, the investigative file description format, contains all the information about the title, the depositor. So this is a very simple, straightforward spreadsheet format that anyone can use. Now, one of the most important aspects that they came up with was an ontology. So, trying to agree on the name of something in biology is really difficult. Trying to convince people that if you say you are pipetting this, what exactly do you mean, how much, whatever. So they came up with their own ontology to specify the different areas within microwave data that they were finding. So if you say liver, that can mean more than one thing. It could mean just the liver, or it could mean a particular area of the liver, or it could mean the entire liver permeability system. So by developing a stable, unambiguous ontology, it makes life a lot easier. So up until this point, gene ontology had been the most successful one, but they decided to construct their own for their own specific purposes. So the MGED ontology, MO, provides all the different aspects for annotating microarray experiment. The array layout, the experimental design, the preparation of materials, also was used to provide semantics for various specific concepts held in Miami. And as a result, they work very closely with various other ontology groups. And if you go to the Open Biomedical Ontology site, this is an initiative to make available and develop further life science-specific ontology. The gene ontology was the best start possible, but it doesn't always capture everybody's interests and everybody's needs. So anyone can develop their own, but if you work closely with the Opal Foundry, then you might find that somebody's already working in that field. Now, the importance of the ontologies will become clear when you actually start using the database. It does have some very important features. Now, ArrayExpress is effectively two databases. There's the ArrayExpress archive, which is all of the microarray data that's been deposited at all to ArrayExpress. This comes from direct submissions, but it also comes from imports from other databases like GIF. So we mass import data when it's been formatted appropriately. Now, a subset of this information is then taken out. There's some additional statistical analysis performed and some manual curation performed. And that becomes the expression atlas, so the gene expression atlas. And both of these link to other EBI services and also link out to Bioconductor or various other tools if you happen to have that or use that data. So what we're going to focus on is the ArrayExpress, but both of these have queries. So the ArrayExpress archive, the database itself, you're usually looking for an experiment or a particular type of sample or a code that you've seen published in a paper. You can filter on the variety of species, array platforms, technologies used. Now the gene expression archive, gene expression atlas, sorry, is very gene focused or very condition focused. So if you're interested in a particular gene's expression and you don't care about the particular conditions that it's found in, you can do that and it will provide all the expression conditions across all the experiments that have been put into the atlas. and it lets you, most importantly, query across different experiments and different platforms, which is something you can't do with the archive itself without doing all the normalization yourself. So the first thing that we'll look at, and then you'll do a short exercise on, is the Re-Express archive itself. So here's another one of these growth charts, and you can just replace the axes with anything, and most biological data you will find a chart that looks a bit like this in some way, shape, or form. The dates will change, but the growth is pretty much the same. So there's a lot of data in there. It comes from a variety of species. The major kind of the breakdown of the species is predominantly human and mouse, which you could probably guess as that would be the focus point of majority of research. But there are a number of other species in there, a couple of plants, chicken, rhodopsis should be in there as well. Yep. And this is a snapshot of the Re-Express homepage. So this box here corresponds to the archive, to the warehouse, and this box here corresponds to the atlas itself. Now you should type terms in here to the searches, but it's a lot better if you actually go into the if you go into each of the databases separately to do the queries, because then you get to use the power of the ontologies. Also on this homepage, out of interest, there are links to other training, help, and programmatic access to the data as well, as well as news. So whenever there's an update to the database or anything's changing, major changes, that will always appear here. So if you were to click on Browse Experiments, what you would end up with is a massive table of every experiment that's on there. And you could just sit and just plod through all the pages and just idly browse through it. Not of any efficient use of your time, and probably not very interesting, but the table that it provides is useful in many ways. So it illustrates each experiment has its own unique identifier, the title of the experiment, the number of assays that are in there, which species was investigated, the date the data was uploaded, and then there are these three columns here. So if there's a symbol in this column, it shows that the process data is available. There's a symbol in this column, it shows that the raw data is available. And if there's a tick in this column, it says it's been added into the atlas. And if it has been ticked, you should be able to click and go straight through to the atlas entry for that experiment. Remember I said there's high throughput sequencing data? Well, when that actually happens, you don't store the raw data in a Re-Express because you're duplicating effort. So what we do is we link to the European Nucleotide Archive, where the raw data is held. There's no point in storing it twice. So that's what this little green symbol means. It's a logo for EMA. And just at the bottom, it tells you how many experiments, how many assays, and then just 632 pages of data. So browsing is probably not the way forward. So the best way to do it is to search. Top of the page, there's a search option, search bar. So you can type in here, a term. You can filter on a particular species, a type and a range. And when you do that, the table will change, and it will give you just the results that you searched for, and it will tell you how many are available. Remember there were these MGED ontologies. Well, one ontology that they came up with is the experimental factor ontology, and this is very, very important for doing any searches within Re-Express or the Atlas. It's an ontology designed specifically for experimental factors in arrays, microarray experiments. And it was developed so that everything is annotated consistently, because it's nothing worse than going somewhere and typing in a search, and just because it's been misspelled in an experiment, it doesn't come up in that list of results. So by having this on experimental factor ontology, people can select specific key terms, and that will be annotated to Now, the terms effectively map onto lots of different domains. So there's cell type ontologies, there's disease ontologies, and they map onto there. And they're, because they're ontology, there are relationships between all the entries. So, for example, within the experimental factors, there's all three types. So you've got disease, eye disease, genetic disorder, neoplasm. And within neoplasm, you've got cancer. So if you select cancer and expand, you would find that it includes carcinoma, mesothelioma, sarcomas. Now, if you were using those terms in a paper and other people read it, you would assume that they knew that you meant cancer. However, automated searches won't know that unless you tell it, and that's what this ontology does. It means that if you just type in cancer, it will give you all of these other searches as well. That's it. It will do all of those searches as well because it knows that those terms belong to that. And you see this when you start typing in. So if you're actually in the warehouse, so you just browse the archive and you go to the search bar, and you start typing in a term, it will use this ontology to suggest things to you. And you can select a term that's much higher up. You should also look for this being an EFO term, rather than, say, a gene ontology term. So you can select that, and it will give you all these others, or you can select the more specific term. So for example, chronic myelogenous leukemia. So very simple queries, using, for example, that search bar, lets you search across all the fields. So you can search just by an accession number, or an experiment name, or the person that deposited the information, or a publication title even, a PubMed ID. And it will always include synonyms for searches. So if you type in human, you will always get searches for Homo sapiens as well. Now, when you do a search, for example, with chronic myelogenous leukemia, it will pull out everything as well as all the synonyms and things that are below it in the ontology. And it will mark up these different terms. So it will highlight in yellow any text that matches exactly what you read. It will mark up in green terms that are synonyms to that. So you can see in this example, you've got chronic myeloid leuka, because it's just been truncated, and that's why it's marked up green. CML is marked up green because it's a known abbreviation for that disorder. And anything that's marked up in pink is a child term within the ontology from this. So something that's lower down in the ontology, that chronic myelogenous leukemia. And each experiment's listed on the side. There's a little plus symbol on the side, and if you expand on that plus symbol, you will get details of that experiment. And it goes through all the different bits of information it stores. So the raw files, it tells you how many of the Miami aspects are met, so you can tell if it's 3 or 5 out of the 5 Miami compliance factors are met. It gives you all the different experimental factors used in the experiment and their values. So there's lots of information there, as well as the contact for the person who deposited the data. So, effectively, the process data comes out with a list of samples and a list of genes, gene annotations, and then the expression levels or the count of the level data are there. So it's just basically a very large grid of numbers. However, within the archive, there are ways of viewing the files in different ways, and there are these new views, which are designed to make some of the data that's held in it a bit more user-friendly. So for example, the sample and data relationship file, so this effectively can be summarized as a nicer table. nice user-friendly view on the raw data. There's also something called the ADF file. So the way design file, and that's linked here. And that will give a lot more details about the exact technology that we've used and the techniques that we've used. It's also linked further up above, so there's multiple ways to get to this. And for those of you who used RVA Express Archive in the past, there's an old interface that's still available to you. However, if you want to get all the available files, there's a, in the files section, there's a browse all available files link. And that will just give you a table of everything. So you can download all the bits that you want, all the bits that you need, look at them in whichever tool that you're interested in or you use regularly. Now, very simple queries are okay, and once you start using it and using it more and more, you might want to do more complex queries. Now, the advanced queries do tend to require you to know a bit more about the structure of the database, but you can do standard combined search terms using and or not. So kidney and cancer or kidney not cancer. If you do want to search for a particular term that's multiple words, you should put them in parentheses. And you can also specify particular fields, but like I said, you really need to know a bit more about the structure of the database to use that well. So for example, you can search for an experimental factor value. So you would type in EFB colon fibroblast to search for that particular term. Or you can restrict on the redesign name, for example, agilon. And even more advanced queries let you filter your results by particular attributes. So for example, if you were only interested in experiments with a particular number of samples, you could restrict the sample count, colon, and then the range of what you want, or the raw count, the number of raw files. So there are much more specific queries that you can make, and quite often they're used to repeat queries. So the person gets a detail of what they search for, writes it down, and then you can just plug this advanced query back in there. So these are examples of advanced queries, leukemia and experimental type transcription profiling, and an assay count of between 10 and 1,000. Or array, A, happy, and then asterisk, or array, actually. Cancer and not mouse. So there are a bit more interesting queries you can do, but you can always save that as a text and say, okay, when I was doing this search, this is the search I used. And then you can plug that back in at a later date. Okay. In exercise one, it was basically just simple questions to just get you used to looking in the warehouse for very specific bits of information. Which is probably the most likely way that we're actually going to use the warehouse in its own right, is finding a particular experiment and then finding a bit of information associated with that experiment. So it was asking you to go to Array Express. You could type that into the URL, or you could just go to the EBI homepage, and the kind of major resources are listed specifically, but there's also this section here that will list all relevant tools and databases according to particular categories of information. So for example, in the gene expression tab, it will give you Array Express, Atlas, and various other tools that are associated. So if I just select the Array Express page, this is the screenshot that we saw in the presentation, and it's this aspect that we're looking at just now. We'll come to this in a second. So if I just go to, you can type in, so it says in the experiments box, type in ataxia. So we can just do that from here. So you'll see that because I practiced this yesterday to make sure everything was working, it's suggesting this. Otherwise, you wouldn't have any suggestions in the box at all from this page. And that's because the queries on this page are not linked to the ontology in any way. So if I just do a standard search for ataxia, see here these terms in yellow are highlighted because they're exact matches to the query. If you actually type things into this query box now that we're in the Express warehouse, it starts suggesting things as I'm typing. So you can see it's suggesting affymetrix arrays or atlas, or there's various other terms here it's suggesting. But basically, the very first question was, how many experiments are retrieved? So this is, very simply, this button that says there are 22 experiments. And this corresponds to 657 assays. So in the printouts, the answers that they've got in the printouts are actually not up to date because it's a constantly changing database. So if I do it next week, the numbers might be different again. It just depends on what's been imported and what's been uploaded. So 22 experiments, 657 assays. And then it's asking about a very specific experiment, and it's EMPXP886. If you actually scroll down the list, you'll find it almost down at the bottom, EMEXP886. So you see some of them are MEXP and some of them are GOD. So the GO ones are obviously data that have been imported from GO, and the EMEXP ones are, I believe, are uploaded to ArrayExpress. So by clicking on the plus sign next to the experiment of interest, it just expands this information within the table. So you can see the rest of the table still there. And it was asking a few questions on this particular experiment. So it's asking, first of all, how many assays does it have? Okay. In this case, you can see from the headings that the number of assays here is 10. So you could actually get that from the summary table without expanding the data. What type of available data is available to download? So remember these three columns. So the processed data and the raw data is available. And also, because it's got a tick, it means that that experiment has been added into the atlas. So by clicking on the tick, it would take you through to the atlas page for that experiment. Okay. Which is the answer to the third question of that section, which is it available in the atlas? And the answer is yes. So, looking into the experiment in more detail, it was asking what experimental factor was investigated and what are its values. So the one way to look at this is if you look further down the list, you get an entry that says experimental factors for this experiment. And in this case, the factor name is genotype, and the factor values are ataxin 1 --, or wild type. So it's basically your double mutant or your wild type are the two conditions. The two genotypes that are being looked at here. How many biological replicants are there for each of the experimental factor values? So the way to view this is to look at the SDRF, which is the sample and data relationship plan. Now remember from the description, one way to look at this is to look in the files section. And there's a sample and data relationship entry. Now you can look at the raw text, which is one way of looking at it. And you'll see that in a second. So it's not exactly a nice way to view things. But if you click on the nice viewer option, it's still a table, but it does give you details of what each of the various columns were. It gives you a bit more information, it just lays it out in a nicer way. So in this case, we're looking at for each of the genotypes, there are five replicates. Because if you look at the genotype column, there are 5 double mutants, and there are 5 wild type. So there are 5 replicates for each genotype. And finally, they were asking about details about the EBI platform that was used. So once again, one way to look at this is to perhaps look at the EBI design file, which is just a plain text file which gives you more information about the EBI design. The EBI design name is an affymetrics gene chip mouse expression array, MOE430A. So that's what it's looking for. Other way to look for it is, it listed in here somewhere? There we go. It's also in the links here. So it says array design affymetrics gene chip mouse expression array, MOE430A. Okay, so that should have been reasonably straightforward. It's just getting you used to some of the layout of this, some of the bits of information you can pull out from any given experiment in the archive. That's why it shouldn't be too long. Okay, so that's the kind of way that you'd explore the archive. It's not, you can do various searches here to look up all experiments that have a particular condition, but the majority of people are likely to find in a paper the ReExpress archive identifier, come here, get the appropriate data, and download it to their machine to do some analysis themselves. That's mostly how this would be used. So we just completed exercise one, and what I'm going to do now is discuss in a bit more detail the gene expression atlas. Now this, from my personal perspective, is probably a lot more useful in the sense of quite often the questions you're asking are, how is this gene upregulated or downregulated across different experiments? Or I'm interested in a gene in a particular part of an organism. I don't want to have to trawl through all the different experiments, pull out the data and do the analysis myself. It's more a case of just giving me some of the key facts that I'm interested in. So this is what this gene expression atlas was really designed for. And like I said, it was a smaller subset of the full archive, so not everything that's in the archive is there, which is one of the limitations. But this is because it's quite a manually intensive process. There's a lot of checking and curation goes into the data, as well as additional statistical analysis. everything goes in there, and there are some strict rules about what gets included in the atlas. So the array designs must be provided so that we can do reannotation using ensemble or in the project, or at least have the potential to do that. We can't just rely on it being dictated as being correct. You have to be able to reanalyze and be able to check that it is correct. Obviously, Miami compliant experiments are better than non Miami compliant, so the higher the scores, like 4 or 5 out of the 5 required aspects, would be included, because they would obviously a better chance of being able to reannotate the data. Each of the experiments must have 6 or more hybridizations, and I believe that's just down to the statistical techniques that are used for normalizing across all the different techniques, across the different experiments, that we need a good number of hybridizations to do this. Sufficient replication in large sample size, that too is also obviously makes it easier to re-annotate or to analyse the data further. It must be well annotated with the experimental factors, and the annotation for the sample preparation as well should be provided, so the sample annotation slide. And we must have the process data, or at least the raw data that it can be renormalised, because otherwise there'd be no way of checking. So that's one of the reasons why not everything can end up in the atlas, is because it may not meet some of these requirements. Okay. So when you construct the atlas, you assume that the data is taken as normalized by the submitter, and then you calculate the differential expression across different experiments across different conditions. So the result gives you a two-dimensional matrix where the rows correspond to the genes and the columns correspond to the conditions rather than samples. So remember, I showed you that grid earlier, and it was genes down one side and samples along the top. In this case, it's genes down one side and conditions along the top. That's how it works. And the entries into the matrix are the p-values. So the p-values for the expression over or under expression, along with the sign, which indicates whether it's which direction the differential expression is found. So effectively, what we're doing is, in one experiment, you've got a list of genes, a list of conditions, you're performing a statistical test, and you're getting a value out of that, okay, for whether it's up or down, that would be 1, 0, -1. For experiment 2, list of genes, different conditions, experiment N. So we're doing this for lots of different experiments, and then combining the information into the atlas. So, for example, a list of genes here, you've got the control, you've got 2 conditions. Gene A is downregulated in this condition, upregulated in the other. Gene B, up. Gene Z, up, or no differential expression. Okay. So the colour coding here is red is upregulated, blue is downregulated, white means there's no differential expression. So that's experiment 1's data, that's experiment 2's data, so you've got down, down, up, down, up, down, and then experiment 3, you've got a different pattern of expression. And then what we're doing is then combining these so that gene A across, you can see in this case, we've got 3 situations where it's down-regulated in the condition EML. In the condition CML, gene A is upregulated, downregulated, and upregulated. So there are 2 red to 1 blue. And if you look at the same for gene B, you've got 2 red, 1 blue, can see is a white one here. So gene Z has, in condition C, ML, has one no differential expression and two down arrows. That's the pattern. And this is the thing that you'll get out in the atlas when you're looking. And this is what you're looking at in the atlas. So, once again, if you do searches here, it just does a literal search for what you're typing in. To use the power of the ontology, you're much better going into the atlas itself. So I'd always advise going to the atlas and do the searches from there, because the searches are much more efficient from that way. Now, the searches here are slightly different. You're looking for genes. You can restrict by the direction of expression. So you can say only upregulated or only downregulated. You can even search for ones that are show no differential expression. You can specify the particular organism you're interested in, and you can specify particular conditions. For example, cancer, diabetes, liver, brain, all of these things. And then the advanced query lets you build up more complex queries than this will allow. You can type multiple terms into this and use the ontology to select multiple terms and do the search across all. So, the genes box, as you start typing in a gene name, it will start making suggestions. So in this case, I've started to type SA, so it's suggesting SAA, SAA2, SA-2, SAA4 boven. There's all kinds of things here. And it tells you where, it tells you the ensemble gene identifier, it tells you the species. So the first one is human, second is human, there's a couple from Bill, one from Aridoxus as well. But it also provides things like there's genes, but it also looks for interpol terms and various other terms as well. And in the conditions box, if you start typing in, it will make suggestions once again, and it uses this ontology. So if you start typing in carcinoma, it will start off with things higher up in the ontology, basically. It will try to bring the most likely things to the top. So in this case, disease or carcinoma, and there's various other suggestions. It also gives you in brackets here slight indicator of how many genes have that term, so it gives you a rough idea of the data set that you're searching within. But you can also expand on that, and that will give you a link into the ontology itself, and you can navigate your way through if you're looking for a particular term. But you're better off just typing in here and see what comes up. So there are a couple of types of queries. Single gene query, quite straightforward. Type in SAA4, we've got three suggestions here. I think possibly we'd probably suggest to pick the human or the mouse example. In this case, I've picked the mouse. So if you type in a gene and just search Atlas without specifying any queries or conditions, then it will take you to that gene page. So each entry in the Atlas has a gene page, and there's also an experiment page for each entry as well. So this is the SAA4 page in mouse. It gives you some basic background information about the gene, some links to Interpol, lets you link out to other databases like Uniprot and various others. It also provides, on the right-hand side of the page, graphical representations of all the expression profiles of every experiment that shows differential expression for that gene in the mouse. So this list of, I think there's 20, 30 pages of expression profiles here, and it lists this in order of p-value. So the one that comes up at the top is the most statistically significant differential expression. Okay. For each of the experimental factors, there's a table giving you information about the value of that factor and which experiments were showed differential expression and which direction that was in. There is also an organogram, not an organogram, yeah, animogram, basically a picture of the organism and where those bits are. And if you show expression data for all values, it provides a table underneath that expands in more detail which parts of the brain these experiments are found in. So I said that there's a gene, for every gene there's a page in the atlas, but for also each experiment that's important, each experiment also has its own page. So an experiment page looks like this. You've got information about the platform used, the samples, and the array express identifier. The default was to give you a bar chart, I believe, for the differentially, the most differentially expressed genes in that experiment. But you can also view this as a line plot. And then there's a table at the bottom that gives you more details about the information that's in this false plot or line plot. Now, for the high throughput sequencing data, the layout's pretty similar, except that there's an option for a genome view, because obviously it's high throughput sequencing data and that information can be mapped. So in this case, it's mapped onto whereabouts in the genome it is, and that should be familiar from yesterday from the ensemble section that we did. Okay, so you can search for genes. That's one way of doing things. Another type of query that is quite often found is that people are only, they don't care about the genes in particular. They're bothered by, they want to investigate a particular organ or an organelle or something like that. So a conditions-only query will search all experiments where any up or down regulated any organism in the liver, and it pulls out all the information about that. And once again, as you start typing it in, you get experimental factor ontology suggestions. Now, I would always recommend that you pick the EFO term, because that's going to be a more complete search, whereas other suggestions might not give you a complete data, because only if it's been annotated, say, an integral term, will it be picked up as a search. And no matter whether you do a gene, you can do multiple genes, incidentally. If you start typing in here, select one, and then start typing again, it'll give you another suggestion. And then you can do 3, 4, 5, 6, with however many genes. The same with the conditions, you can add multiple conditions. But however you do it, you will get a table of results back with this heat map format. So in this case, been looking for conditions, any experiment that has off-or-down regulation in the liver, and you can see that there are a number of genes here, and each of the factors in the ontology are listed. So you've got liver, liver brackets, human, liver brackets, mouse, and it gives you a breakdown of each. So clicking on each of any one of these in particular will give you a list of the expression profiles for those 31 experiments in this case. The other way to view this is, rather than use a heat map, there's a list option, and all it does is do the same search, but it just provides you the results back as a table, basically. So for each of the conditions, there's a table, and then you can click the expression profile to get to the different sequences. So it's the same information, it's just a slightly different way of viewing it, so it's up to you changing database as you write up, you might need to know what date, what version of the database it was. So it's always good to be able to download and timestamp these things. So one way of doing this is there's a download all results, and that will give you a final table of all the results back as well. So you can store and look at them your own time without having to worry whether that information has changed in the week after. Okay, so in this example, this is actually a slightly different example. It's not specifically looking for a genes in this case. The query here is the WNT receptor signaling pathway. So you can actually search by pathways as well. So if you're interested in apoptosis, if you type apoptosis into the genes bar, it should suggest it as a term. Click on that, and then any gene that's been tagged as being part of the apoptosis pathway will be included in your search. And so all of these genes here are part of this, or have been tagged as being part of this receptor signaling pathway. So in this case, we're looking for all genes in a pathway, up or down regulated in human, in cancer, well, in carcinoma specifically. So this gives you a massive heat map of all the results, and you can see there's one in ovarian carcinoma, there's 14 in general carcinoma. But you can refine this query further. So if you click on this refine your query option, what it does is it brings, it expands the page slightly and creates a little table here to the side, which is a refine your query. So out of all of the hits from this table, there are a number of other experimental factors. So for example, these things are associated with particular proterms, or interproterms, or diseases. So you can say, okay, let's see all the experimental factors that are also detailed within this set of results. And say in this case, it's interproterms, and I'm only interested in anything that has a serine, threonine, protein, kinase domain. So if you click on that particular item, it will then cut down the results in the table to only those that have that as well. The other way to make a more complex query is to use the advanced search, and basically that builds up a query by adding conditions. So looking for an organism in at least one in human, at least one experiment is upregulated in carcinoma and has a genotology term, receptor signaling pathway, you can then add other conditions onto this and just build up more complex queries bit by bit. So here we've also added another term, it's a genotology term, transcription regulation. So the results have been cut down as a result of that additional. So you're focusing in further to find out the exact query that you're looking for. So exercise two, it was a single gene query, was the initial thing we were doing. So it said to go to the gene expression atlas. So if you go to the Express homepage and go to the Atlas homepage, and you link there, you get your search bar at the top. So in the genes box, it was suggesting that we type MAT1A. So if I start typing in MAT1A, you can see it starts changing the suggestions. So there's quite a few genes here. Suggested, and in this case we're interested in the mouse gene. So we're looking for musculus ensemble mouse gene identifier. So I click that. I've now added that particular gene from that organism into the query, and then we're going to leave all the other searches blank, which is anything that's up or down regulated across any species in all conditions. because we typed in a gene from a particular organism, we just end up going to the gene page within the atlas. So we saw this earlier. This stuff at the top is just an explanation of some of the more details about that gene with links to other databases. Now, if you expand on show more properties, you can see it cross-references to lots of different databases. Okay? So there's all kinds of information there, should you wish it. However, the bit that we're interested in is which experiment, which conditions or experimental factor is this gene most up or down regulated? So we're looking for both. So we're looking at experimental factors here. So one experimental factor is organism part, another one is cell line, another one is disease state. So each of these different experimental factors has the number of experiments where that is up or down regulated, or no differential expression. So if we take a look at organism part, from this summary, you'd be expecting the liver to be the most upregulated. This gene is more upregulated than the liver because there's more evidence for that across lots of different experiments. And in the renal system, it's mostly downregulated. There's one up and eight downregulated in the brain as well. So if we look at all expression data for all values of this factor, one thing to notice is this expression profile now shows 31 experiments because that's all there was within the organ, this experimental factor. So there's only 31 experiments where the organism part is identified out of 100 experiments. So not all of them are obviously both this experimental factor. However, looking at the table which details each of these in more depth, you see that the liver is still the most upregulated experimental factor. And if you scroll down to the bottom of the table, you see that the kidney is the most downregulated. In fact, actually, the number of experiments are 6 downregulated and 4 showing no differential expression. So this is what I mean about interpretation. So there are 4 experiments where there's no significant differential expression, but there's 6 that say it's downregulated. It's almost half and half. So it's not 100% clear that that's true. You'd have to look into that more depth. Okay, so most upregulated in the liver, mostly downregulated in the kidney. And now we want to look in more detail at the liver. So you want to look at these 20 experiments in the liver. If you click on anywhere in this line on that table, it changes the expressions again. So now you can see there's only 20 experiments listed. 20 profiles listed, and that's the 20 profiles that correspond to the 20 experiments that looked at liver and this gene. Okay. So, how many experiments was MAP A upregulated in the liver? So obviously in the previous time that we did this, there were only 12 experiments, and that's what's in the answers, but now the results are suggesting there's 20 experiments. So any more information that you want about this, you click from here and you get the profiles. And it was asking about which one of these is most significant. Is the differential expression more significant? this case, you're basically looking at this list here of experiments. This first experiment that comes out on top is the most statistically significant differential expression because it's ranked by the p-values of expression. So this one's the most, then this one, and so on. So actually, in this case, it's E tab n 1039 is the most, shows the highest differential expression. It's most significant that differential expression, so. Okay? Now, in the previous set of results, the top listing was E-geode 4262. And in this case, in the new set of results, it's actually on the next page of results. So if I go to the next page, scroll down, that's the experiment that previously came out on top in the last set of searches. And in this case, they were looking for, if you click on profile, it takes you to the experiment page for that experiment in the Atlas. Now, this is the bit that I said you couldn't be able to answer. It was saying what other genes have similar expression to MAT1A. So this is the MAT1A expression. And there was a similarity search, but that's been disabled for the moment, unfortunately. The other way to do it, I suppose, would be to just take out the requirement for there to be a specific gene, and it will just show you all the genes with the highest differential expression within that experiment. So you can see here, there are three genes that seem to have quite similar profiles. So similar downregulation in the colon, duodenum, and upregulation in the liver. So that's one way that you can compare this. And remember I said there were line plots as well. So this shows you the actual expression across the different parameters. So that was exercise two. It was just to get used to doing a gene search and find out the types of things you can ask. And apologies for the fact that the similarity search is not active, as it's a very useful feature to have. So exercise three was looking at multiple genes but in the context of a pathway. So in this case, we're looking at neuropeptide signaling pathway. So if I start typing in neuropeptide signaling, now note that it's a single L, not a double L. Neuropeptide signaling pathway is a gene ontology term. So I'm going to use that in this case. And we're only also looking in the mouse, and we're also only interested in the brain. So if I do from the drop-down menu musculus, and if I start typing in brain, you can see there's lots of suggestions here. So you can see there's lots of suggestions for the word brain. So brain, adult brain, is an experimental factor ontology term, and that's the one I would suggest that you use because it's the most inclusive. Whereas there is a term organism part, brain, there's also various other groupings that are to do with another experiment, so you don't need to worry about the groups. But you can see that the ontology term is going to have 69,000 genes, whereas the term organism part, brain, has only 46,000. So the ontology is pulling in a lot more genes from other experiments because of this hierarchical relationship. So if I select brain, the EFO term, that's the query that we're looking for. So the two major points that we're looking for here is how many genes matching all of these criteria are retrieved, and how many carry a particular type of domain, a GPS domain. So in this case, we have 76 genes part that are annotated as being part of this pathway in a mouse, in the brain, that are differentially expressed. So in this case, it's 76 genes. And what we wanted to do was to narrow down the search or refine the search in more detail. And one of the ways we wanted to do that was to look at a particular domain. So refining your query brings up the fact that out of all of these 76 genes in these different conditions, there are goal terms to do with the plasma membrane, protein-coupled receptors, GPS domains, interproterms on GPCR-like domains, etc. However, we were interested in how many have GPS domain. So if you click on that, it changes the query to add in and must also have GPS domain as an interproterm associated with the gene. So you can see this is a similar, this is what you would have to do if you were building the advanced query. You'd have to do find genes in mouse, at least one experiment up or down regulated in the brain, has this pathway, has the proton. And then you can modify this here. So if you wanted to narrow down, actually I want to have lots of experiments where it's up or down regulated. In this case, it only needs one experiment to be up or down regulated to be counted, but it could be more stringent in your search. But for the query that we had, there were 30 in total that found. And you can see there's quite a variety of different patterns of expression there. And if I wanted to show you the list view, to do the same. So those were the two exercises to do with the atlas. And it was really just to get used to the idea that once you come in, you can search for particular genes. So you can do MAP1A. You can also do SA4. So this is what I meant by you can start, you can add multiple genes in to the search. You can also do multiple conditions, so you can type liver, brain, cancer. Don't know if this video will actually work, because it's just, you know. But that's searching those two genes, so you can see in this case, because we searched for two particular genes, and this is the expression profiles across all these different conditions. And you can see in here the ontology and how it works. So you've got cancer, and then a subpart of that is carcinoma, adenocarcinoma, leiomyosarcoma, all the way along here to the different types. And then the next thing was central nervous system, lymphoid, sarcoma, liver, brain. See exactly where the different sections were from your query. Okay. last bit is really just to mention, for those of you who are working on this, how you submit to the AEXPRESS, how the submission process works. So on that set of links on the homepage, there's a submit data link. If you go there, it will give you further details on how that works. So there are two kind of ways to submit data. There's a spreadsheet, so remember this MAGE tab format that we came up with. It was to enable people to create the spreadsheet and then submit the spreadsheet to the site and then they could upload the data. But there's also an online submission tool, but that's restricted to less than 50 hybridizations. Whereas the spreadsheet, you can have as many hybridizations as you want, because when you submit the spreadsheet, you can then split up the data and do the processing in a more sensible way without the online one crashing on people. Okay. So fundamentally, what will happen is you submit in either of these formats. There will be a curator will be assigned to the task. They will check the information that you've uploaded. You'll get given an accession number for that data, and then they'll start processing it. And then that will be then uploaded into AEXPRESS, where you'll be given a link, or reviewers for your paper will be given a link as well to that upload. That's not yet public, and only once the data is to be made publicly available, usually post-publication or on publication, then it's converted into the public access site. And made fully available. Okay. That's kind of roughly the pipeline. Once again, high throughput data information is slightly different, quite similar in many ways, but slightly different. They submit through this MAGE tab submission route. There's no online service for that. You submit the spreadsheet with the details, you submit all the trace files to each sample, you also submit the process data files. For non-human species, the files that you submit, the SRF and FASTQ files, then go to the European Nucleotide Archive, where they're stored and only made available once the AEXPRESS data is available. However, if you have any human identifiable sequence data, you need to submit it to a different group. So it needs to go through the European Genome Archive and not AEXPRESS. And it's done in a slightly different way. So non-human and human data that's non-identifiable, you can submit directly to AEXPRESS, and AEXPRESS translates the raw data files to the European Nucleotide Archive. Where in conditions where you can actually identify patients from samples or from sequences, that has to go to the European Genome Archive, and then gets the metadata is then sent to AEXPRESS, but not everything. So it's the data is modified before it's submitted. And that's the only condition. This is the only thing in the EBI that's private. So private in the sense of you cannot make publicly available data that could be traced to an individual. So this data is stored securely. And if anyone wants to access it, they have to write to them with valid justifications for accessing the data. They'll be asked to provide what it is they would like, and then the annotators in the EGA will then send them the information they need. That's after it's been anonymized, so that they can't identify patients. So that's the only bit of information that's not publicly, openly accessible for everybody. So after submission, we get an email confirmation, the curation team reviews it, there's some editing back and forth possibly, and then when everything's provided, you get your accession number that's added into AEXPRESS. And you get a reviewer login as well that you can pass on. So, welcome back from lunch, the very tricky after lunch session. So, I will try not to fall asleep. You also promised. Heat and food does not make for very good post-lunch sessions. So anyway, we've had AEXPRESS this morning, we've had an introduction to EBI, and we're going to look at Reacto, which is pathways, pathways database. So Reactome is specifically a database of human paths, biological pathways, but don't be put off by the fact that it's human-centric. That was because of its original construction. There are links out to other organisms and there are inferences based on these. So these presentations and exercises are being designed by our Reactome team, in particular Stephen Duke from the Reactome team provided me with these materials. They have their own training team and their own help desk, so for any queries you can also contact the Reactome team as well. So what is the point in Reactome? Why is it there? So if you take a look at this extract from an article, there's a big bit of text, and if you read that over some time, you will understand the concepts that are there, and you'll be able to identify some bits and pieces. So the things here in red seem to be complexes, or gene names, or something. The green text here, you can identify as being referring to a pathway. The blue terms seem to be interactions, or types of interaction, or, so for example, ligand binding, or membrane bound. These are particular terms that have an association. And this text in brown is a reference link. So you reading this, you can make sense of it. Computers find this a lot more difficult. There are text parsing, text processing algorithms out there, but they're still not quite up to the same level as a human is for reading text and understanding concepts there. So basically, how can you access this pathway information that's clearly there? And we use it in some way. So that was why the outcome was there. In addition, quite often in publications you'll find diagrams. So this figure you can look at and you can understand and see, okay, this is part of the pathway, this does this, this goes there. Now, picture paints 1,000 words, but once again, they are just effectively pixels on a screen. Computers are very difficult, find it very difficult to process images without a lot of training. And actually, figures don't show everything that's there. There's a lot of assumptions that you know certain bits of information because they don't put every single step in a reaction or every single thing that possibly interacts as part of a complex. They just assume that you know that a particular membrane protein is a complex of four others. They assume that there are various bits in here that you can understand that this links to this and that links to that to form a much larger complex. So there are a lot of assumptions. There's lots of missing data as well. But for people, it's easy to understand. Also, can't be sure if this is actual fact or whether this is a hypothesis. Is it known that this truncation happens and this interaction happens, or is this just being inferred by the people who published the paper? So that's another reason why Reactome is here. So effectively, it's a free, open access, open source, online curated database of pathways and reactions in human biology. It's authored by experts and maintained by the Reactome editorial staff, the curators, and it's also mapped into the cellular component. The diagrams that we use in Reactome have boxes around them to indicate exactly which component of the cell these various bits occur in. Now, the expert biologists are not solely staff on site. The staff on site are the curation team. The expert biologists are quite often researchers in the field, and they contribute a lot of the information that's in there. It's also got lots of cross-references. tools to analyse the data that's in there. You can analyse the pathways, you can map your gene list onto pathways, you can overlay expression data, and there are other methods of accessing the data like BioModel. And it's also used to infer orthologous events in other species. So this is why I said don't worry if it's not human that you're working on. There are 20 non-human species where some of the pathways or aspects of them have been inferred. So, this inference can work in many ways. So, in the human, you've got direct evidence for two genes in a pathway, in a process. There is additional indirect evidence from mouse and cow that these two things exist. Now the pathway human is there, and therefore these things are homologs in other organisms. And if there are enough of these inferred in another organism, you can infer the pathway as well. But it has to have a certain amount of certain proportion of the components of a reaction have to be present in order for you to infer the full pathway. You can't just rely on one bit of evidence to say, well, because there's just this one gene, all of this exists. So, within reactome is effectively the units that build up reactome are pathway steps. And these are biological events, and they will mean something to you. So for example, you've got binding, dissociation, degradation, dephosphorylation, phosphorylation, transport, classic kind of biochemical processes. And all of these have different symbols in reactome. And there is, as part of the tutorial, there's a kind of handy guide to all of the different types of interactions. So for example, an enzymatic reaction. So you've got 5' nucleotides, cytosolic, and this is taking AMP in water, and you get the orthophosphate in the density now. As a cofactor. Another example is a transport. So here, this reaction is calcium, because it's just transporting it from the lumen to the cytoplasm. Okay. So there are other reaction types there as well: dimerization, binding, phosphorylation, dephosphorylation. And each of these little individual units is what's used to build up into a pathway. So, for example, you've got input one, output, a catalyst. That then becomes an input for another reaction, then becomes the catalyst for a third reaction. So this is how we build up all of the pathways. You take each little bit and you construct a pathway. So this is what you would expect. And this goes back again to say that we do mark up the items in the pathway when we construct one as to which gene products or which points were inferred from other organisms. Now, the data in Reactome links out to a vast number of different areas, in particular link out to Go, KEBI, small molecules data, Uniprot, so any protein data that's there links out. We also link out to the sequence databases, a wide variety of them, as well as literature for identifying all the different events, the evidence for the events. So, remember I said that it's a human-centric database, but there are 20 other organisms. So you can switch between different species. So say you've got one particular pathway the screen, you can switch between different species and it will change what you view based on what's available or what knowledge can be transferred. So not only does the inference come from other species, you can infer out to other species. So projecting information to other species is quite tricky. But within human, for example, you've got this pathway, A plus A to B, using B gives you A P plus B. So it's just a phosphorylation thing. In the mouse, there's a homolog to A, there's a homolog to B, so you can probably infer this reaction. However, in the fly, there is no homolog to A. Even though there's a homolog to B, you really can't infer that reaction exists in the fly because you've got no way of knowing that this actually can occur. This could be doing something completely different in the fly. Okay. And there are rules about what can be inferred. You can also export the data. And this is inferred from complexes and reactions. You can get lists available from downloads of all the stuff that's in the data, but that's in the database. But you can, if you take a look at the README document, you get more details about what can be exported in protein-protein interactions. So the coverage, there's information about what is already in the database, but there's also information about what's planned, what's coming up in the future. And the table of contents will be able to tell you that. With an editorial calendar that tells you when the next release is and what's planned to be put into the database and who's responsible for adding the information in. So this reviewer is also assigned when you have a particular expert who will review the information before it's made publicly available, and in this case, Dean McPherson has been allocated to review the site and the associated events in G1. So this is just an update, but they'll be able to check. There are a variety of tools within Reactome. There's this pathway browser, it's very interactive. In the browser. You could map genes onto pathways and figure out whether your list of genes is overrepresented in one pathway or not. You can overlay expression data on top of pathways, and you'll get a chance to do all of these throughout the exercise. And you can also get information from the intact molecular interactions database. So it can overlay molecular interactions on top of each component within a particular path. And then there's also biomarker, which at the time of the end we'll be able to get a chance to do, which we should do. Okay, so the process that we're going to do this is we'll do a short exercise and then we'll go on and explain a little bit more about the service. Then we'll do another exercise that looks in more depth at what we just learn, rather than do one big talk and then lots of exercises. It's better, we've found, to split this stuff up a little bit. So, the tutorial, which I check if it's not. Yeah, okay. So this document's only got the questions and answers. On the page, on the web page, there's the full electronic tutorial, but I didn't want to have to print it because it's quite detailed and there's quite a lot in there, and just to save on some of the printing, it was deemed to just take the exercises out, and you can get a copy of the electronic one from the site, and it gives you more details on how you answer the questions. But we should be able to do that from the descriptions of what happens in each section. So, as an introduction to Reactome, I think the first exercise is a basic information on the home page of the site. So it's just asking for some basic statistics. And what we're going to do is look at the front page of Reactome. Now remember, Reactome is one of these collaborative projects. So you won't find it directly from on the EBI, so it's not a www.ebi/whatever. Reactome set up its own site. But it is linked from the EBI's Reactions and Pathways site. So the homepage is a navigation bar at the top, just some information about it, downloads, tools, various things you can use. There's this sidebar, which has some various comments and other bits. And this is the search bar for Reactome, so this is where you will type in things like different types of pathways or different genes. And there are four kind of key areas. There's the pathway browser, pathway analysis, species comparison, and expression analysis. And we'll look at those in more depth. They have the main section, which is a little bit about Reactome, online electronic e-tutorial. And they have a pathway of the month, if you want. And I think when you took a snapshot, the pathway of the month was influenza. And they will provide a lot more information about that particular pathway that month. So, exercise one, we'll just give you 5 minutes because this should be very quick to go through. And then I'll just go through the answers and we'll just do it as a step-by-step process. And then you'll have to listen to me for extended periods of time and get a chance to actually go in and play with it, which is the best way to do it. So if I get 5 minutes to try and answer these questions, just go to the Reactome webpage, and this information should be found, should be available on the home page in some way. Okay, so the first question was, what's the latest news item on the Reactome homepage? And at this particular moment in time, it's the fact that two new Reactome papers have just been published. That's July the 11th. In the answers to the electronic tutorial, because the electronic tutorial was built before that date, this June 20 brushed entry was the top news entry. But this is just to show you the news at the bottom of the page. So it was then asking how many human proteins are represented in the Reactome. So the best way to find out about that is to go to the content. And in particular, the statistics should show how many human. So, Homo sapiens, 5,555 proteins represented in the database. Okay. So the third question was, when is the next release of Reactome? And that information will come from the content editorial calendar. Remember I said there's an editorial calendar involved? I go to there. Where was it? It's over. The next release is actually scheduled to occur in September 2011. So very shortly, the Reactome database should be updated and all of this stuff should be added into it. And it was asking, Quince, what's the first new topic that will be included in this next release? And in this case, the first topic is going to be mitochondrial import. It's going to be the next topic. So what we're going to take a look at is what's the bit that you're there for, and that's the pathways themselves. So the pathway browser, I'm just going to explain a bit about it before we do an exercise on it. You've got homepage, so once you've searched for, from the React homepage, if you search for a pathway, you'll be taken to this, and the home here will take you back to the React homepage, the main homepage. There's also analyze, annotate, and upload, and that brings up a variety of tools that you can use to work on this pathway. There's a drop down menu bar for the species selector. You can move just by clicking and dragging about the pathway. You can zoom in, zoom out to see more detail. And there's a key here about some of the major features of the complex, major features of the diagram. So small molecules are small circles, complexes are oblongs in a blue color, proteins are oblongs in a blue color. There's the pathway itself. There's a details panel, and this is predominantly always hidden. Now, in order to reveal it, you would click on the little triangle at the bottom of the screen, and that's important because it gives you a lot more textual detail about what's contained in this diagram up above. It gives you a lot more detailed information, and there's a tiny thumbnail of the entire thing showing what you're looking at that particular moment. Now, the sidebar is also very important because it will highlight the pathway that you're particularly looking at. So this sidebar, the pathways will usually be minimized. So if you want to find out more details of what's in a pathway, you can then expand and expand and expand and drill down into more detail. So this is what I was saying about the pathway hierarchy. You've got information about whether a pathway's been updated or not recently, information about pathways, reactions, and whether something's a black box reaction or not, where they don't know the details of exactly what happens at each step. So, exercise 2, I'll give you another 7 or 8 minutes. What we'll do on this is I want you to search for notch signaling. Remember, there's one L, because all of the spellings in React used American English, not British English. Okay. So if you type in notch signaling with a double L, you'll get nothing back. So until that can be sorted in some way, shape, or form, someone can fix it, listen. The top pathway hit should be the notch signaling pathway, but there will be other hits below that that may not be relevant. This will open up in the pathway browser. And just look at the tab on the left and try and answer some of these questions. And as a hint, some of the questions might require you to open up that detail at the bottom of the page. Okay, I'll stop there and I'll just show you some bits about this. So, it's asking you to look at signaling by notch. So if I type into the search bar, signaling with a single L. So in this case, we're looking at the top hit, which is the halfway signaling by a notch. And I'm just going to let this load up. So you'll see these are all the pathways that are in the axon, and it's taken us to signaling by a notch. So the diagram, I zoom out. That's the entire pathway relating to signaling by notch. Now we're going to ignore the diagram for the minute and concentrate on this bar for the next few questions. So the first question was, how many sub-pathways does this pathway have? So how many sub-pathways does signaling by notch have? If I click on the plus sign to expand that, see 7 individual sub-pathways. So in this case, there are 7 sub-pathways to notch signal. And in the first of these sub-pathways, so the transport of notch receptor precursor, it's asking how many reactions are in the first of these. So to find out more, would expand. And you'll see that this has changed from, it's very difficult to see perhaps at the back, but the symbol that's next to it is changed to something else. So it's no longer a pathway, it's now a reaction because it's two points going to a single thing rather than a small network. So these symbols do have significance within them, so if you're ever wondering exactly what it is that you're supposed to be looking at, then that will give you a guide. So the transport of notch receptor precursor pathway or subpathway has 4 individual reactions within it. So in this case, 4 reactions. Okay, and within this, what reaction follows notch to precursor transport to homology? So the reaction that follows this, your natural assumption would be it's the next one down on the list. Now, quite often that would be the case, but it's not always the case. So to find out exactly, you have to use this show details tab. So the signaling by notch pathway, further details, gives you information about the stable identifier, who authored it, who reviewed it, and some basic text about the pathway. I'll scroll down further. Diagram. And if you keep scrolling down, you'll find out more information. So the organism, the biological process, equivalencies, etc. Okay, so that's information about the general pathway. If I minimize that, and we are interested in the notch 2 precursor, so if I click on that, you'll see the image has changed, and that's where we're focusing. And if I provide the more details tab this time, you see it's slightly different, because you're looking at specific reaction within a pathway now. So this is the notch 2 precursor transport to Golgi reaction. It's got a specific identifier. It tells you what the reaction is, and then it tells the input and outputs. And then most importantly, it's got this following events. So the next event actually in the pathway, the next reaction after this, is actually notch 2 precursor cleave to form a heterodimer. So that's what it was that we're looking for here. So don't always assume that in this, the thing that's further, that's down in the list, is the next thing in a pathway. You should always look in more detail, because this following event or events is always the accurate information. there, so you can go down and have a look and see. Because it's entirely possible that these four reactions happen in parallel, so it's not necessarily that one follows the other. Okay. So I think that answers the three questions from the exercise two. And it gives you a bit of information about how this sidebar works and how you can find out further details about a specific reaction within a pathway. Okay. So that's exercise two. Now, you've had a look at the sidebar, and now we want to look at the actual browser itself in a bit more detail. So there are specific things you should be aware of. Proteins are basically boxes. Protein sets, mixed sets, so yes, the boxes here are either individual proteins or complexes of proteins. And you can right-click on a box to find out if there's more detail there, so if there's other proteins that make it up as part of a complex. There are a variety of inputs and outputs, and these are created in a way you would expect, one going in through and out to the others. The reaction is labelled as a node. Ovals are small molecules, generally speaking, whereas square boxes are proteins, and green boxes are proteins, and blue ones are complexes. So you can easily identify which is a complex and which is a single protein, which is a small molecule, and the direction of any pathway. There are also compartments. So in this case, you can see anything on this side of the box is in the cytosol. And any reaction that involves either regulation in some way, shape, or form. Positive regulation is provided by an arrow, a pointed arrowhead, whereas negative regulation is a line and then stopping short with a horizontal line. So that's negative regulation. Each of the boxes, or each of the nodes, reaction nodes, can be different shapes, different colours, well, different shapes and different fill or entities. So transition, binding, dissociation, emitted, uncertain. These all have very specific symbols associated with them. And there is a principal key to all of the pathway diagrams you can have from the website that will let you have it side by side, so that when you're looking at a pathway you don't have to constantly go back and forth and find out. You can just look at the guide and say, well, that's a dissociation. Okay, so exercise three, is what we're going to do is we're going to look at the pathway diagram in more detail. And we're going to pick a different pathway. So you need to go back to the Reactome homepage and search for effects of PIP2 hydrolysis in the search bar again. Select the top pathway hit, which should be this pathway, and then start to answer these questions. What symbol represents the reaction? What symbol represents these other reactions? And what's the catalyst? And various other questions. I'll give you a slightly bit more time on this because it involves a few more steps than previous other sequences have done. Okay, I'll just show you this. Hydrolysis. Okay, so selecting that pathway has brought us here to G alpha Q signaling events, and in particular, the effects of PIP2 hydrolysis. So first thing it's asking for is what symbol represents the reaction for binding of IP3 to the IP3 receptor? So you can kind of just drag it about, have a look and see, or you can expand pathway a little bit more, and you'll find that the first thing on the list is the binding of IP3 to IP3 receptor. And by clicking on that, it takes you to the exact point. There's a box around the node, which is the reaction, and it tells you that you can use that to show where that reaction is in the path. So it was asking what symbol represents the reaction. In this case, it's a solid black circle, and that corresponds to basically a binding interaction, so it's an association event of some description, which is pretty much usually binding. So it's a black circle or solid circle. The next question was, what symbol represents the reaction transport of calcium from platelet dense tubular system to cytoplasm? And once again, you can drag about looking for it. Or you can click on the specific reaction. So in this type, basically the symbol here is an empty square, and empty squares correspond to transition events. Okay. So that's a transition. And the third aspect, third question that we had, is what's the catalyst, the descriptive name, for hydrolysis to a rapid domain? Can you find it in the prop ID and name the two outputs? So you could, once again, scroll about and see if you could find it. But always better to try and find the reaction somewhere. So we're looking at 2-AG hydrolysis. So right. So remember, arachidonate production is a sub-pathway of this PIP2 hydrolysis pathway. So by expanding on it, you find there's a specific reaction to AG hydrolysis. So by clicking on that, once again, takes you in and zooms in on it. So the catalyst is indicated by the fact that there's a line with a circle at the end of it. That in the reaction key is catalyst. So anything that goes up to a node with a circle at the end of it is a catalyst. So in this case, it's monoglyceride lipase. That's the catalyst. And if you expand, if you click on it, that's the catalyst. And you expand the information at the bottom, you get more details about the catalyst itself. So it links to other databases, but it gives you there the reference to Unicrot. So it's Q99685 is the Unicrot identifier for this. And the two outputs. two major outputs are rapid elite and ghost rock. But remember, there's also this third item. Okay, so that helps answer exercise three questions. And now we're going to do a bit more of navigating through the Trout pathway browser, because it's all fair and well doing one reaction that's quite straightforward with a few, one pathway with a handful of little reactions in it, but that's not always going to be the case. And in this case, we're going to take a look at apoptosis, because it's a much more complicated situation, and what you get initially is not clear. So, the home and analyze buttons are up the top. If you pick a particular pathway, there's a box around it. Now, in this case, there are multiple pathways, and two of them associate with one another. So it's kind of like a pathway of pathways on. And at this level, the information that you're getting is specific to that extrinsic or intrinsic pathway. Depends how you get into it. So if you're interested in, say, for example, the extrinsic pathway for apoptosis, you click there, and that will give you more details. And it highlights exactly which one you're looking at on both the diagram and the list. And as always, further details are below. So the details are always relevant to what you've clicked on. Is one thing you've got to remember. So if you clicked on an entire pathway, the details will be about the pathway in general, whereas if you clicked on a reaction, it's only going to tell you about that reaction. It doesn't give you all the pathway information as well. Okay. In addition, you might need to zoom in and out or zoom around, in which case the button's there to help you do that. By clicking on any of these aspects, it will highlight the relevant points on the diagram, and once again, the details are specific to what you've just clicked on. So, the next exercise, we're going to take a look at apoptosis. I want you to open the pathway apoptosis in the pathway browser, select the intrinsic pathway, and then answer some questions about that. About 7 minutes. Yeah, it should be enough time to have a quick look at this. Okay, just going to show you this. So, apart from doing search, you can also just go straight into the pathway browser, which will say to view a pathway. But what it's going to do is just load up list of pathways that's in Reactome, and as we're looking at apoptosis, which come out pretty much top of the list, there's a new amyloids pathway in there. But as we're interested in apoptosis, it's fine. And clicking on it, you get the intrinsic and extrinsic pathways. Now, we were interested in intrinsic pathway, so if you click on that, it will show you some information. So, how do you open the pathway diagram for this sub-pathway? By just left-clicking, it doesn't actually open it as such. So you can see it's just highlighted it. So in order to open it, you would right-click on that image and do go to pathway. Okay? And then that will take you into the full pathway. Now you can see it's zoomed into a very tiny part in the middle. If I actually zoom out, make it absolutely tiny. You see the clicking works two ways actually. If you click on any item in the pathway, it will take you to it in the corresponding column. what we're interested is, with this open, what happens if you click on the sub-pathway, a particular sub-pathway? Actually, if I zoom in, I'll get a better idea. So we're interested in activation of PhD on the microbes. Or PhD only proteins associated with an inactivate anti-apoptose BCL2 members. So by clicking on it, it highlights on here parts that are involved in that sub-pathway. So that's what it's trying to get you to have a look at and see. Because it has three sub-reactions, and that's what those three green boxes are in the diagram. Okay. So the third question was, what happens if you click on a particular reaction? Sequestration. It moves and centers on that particular reaction. So that's all that this exercise is for. It's really just to show you, if you're dealing with a much more complex pathway, you might need to right-click to go into a sub-area. If you select a particular area, it will highlight all the reactions on the diagram, and if you click on one particular reaction, it will zoom in on that particular reaction in the diagram. Okay. Okay, so more information on the details panel, the stuff that's underneath the diagram. There's lots of information there. So the input present at the start of the reaction gives you some details of what's there to begin with, plus all of these links link out to all different databases. It provides the following events, so it tells you exactly what the next step is, and it also gives you information about equivalent events in other organisms. So you can see whether this reaction is found in dog or mouse or rat or any of the organisms that we have, over 20 of them. Okay, so the next exercise is looking at that area in particular, the event details tab at the bottom. And so we're going to find a particular reaction. You can just type that in search. In the whole search box. You're looking to find out which cellular component this reaction takes place, what's the associated goal molecular function, what reference verifies it, and whether that reaction is predicted to occur in dogs or yeast. So we'll give you 5 minutes because it's basically, once you've found the reaction, all of the answers to these questions will be found in that table in the further details at the bottom. So all you have to do is open the reaction, post it up at the bottom, and you'll be able to answer those 4 or 5 questions. Okay, so within exercise 5, it's asking you to look at a particular reaction. So activating type 1 receptor, as well as rsNMP directly. Now, in this case, because it's type 1, type 1 is capital I, so I put I in. I think if you type 1 with a numeric 1, it will pick it up. But the rest of the text is obviously picked up, and that's why this reaction comes out on top. So if I pick that reaction, when it's highlighted that specific reaction here, first of all, what pathway this belongs to. So one of the ways to do that is to look at this on the side, and obviously it's part of the signaling by TGF beta. So, it tells you that that's the pathway that it belongs to. We then need to expand this box at the bottom to find out more details. Which is asking, in which cellular compartment does this reaction take place? So, by looking in more details, you can find a cellular compartment entry. It says here it's early endosome membrane. That information links out to whole genotology. Okay. So, what's the associated whole molecular function? Because that's a whole molecular component. If you're looking for the function, there's another entry for molecular function that says transmembrane receptor protein serine threonine kinase activity. So that's the answer to that question. It was then asking you what references verify this reaction, and just by scrolling further down you find references section, and here is Suchel-Munitsky et al. It's the publication, and it gives you the link to PubMed as well. And it was asking if this occurs or is predicted to occur in Canis familiaris or in Saccharomyces cerevisiae. And by finding out, you just look through the equivalent events in other organisms. And if you look down the list, you'll find Canis familiaris, which is correct, but you do not find Saccharomyces in that list. So yes to the dog and no to the beast. Okay. So that's a short series of exercises to kind of get you navigating the reactor using the browser, using the images, using the links, and using the additional information. Now we're interested in the tools that we've got available. So the first one we've talked about is pathway analysis. So you're not browsing a pathway anymore, you're actually doing some analysis on it. And by clicking on that, you go to a different table. You go to a different page. And what this pathway analysis tool lets you do is you provide it with a list of protein, genes, expression data, compound identifiers, and you can use that to determine how likely they are to affect particular pathways or to be involved in particular pathways. So the identifiers it will accept are Uniprot IDs, GenBank identifiers, DBJ reference numbers, Affymetrics probe IDs, Illumina probe IDs, and various other identifiers as well. And you just put it in a big list and then analyze. So you can upload a list or you can just type it all in. On the page, there's an example, and for the exercise, just use the example data. If you want to run a list of your own identifiers, then by all means, feel free, but you won't be able to answer any of the exercises. So, use the example list and it will provide, it will paste a pile of identifiers into the table and then press analyze to get the results back. Now when you do this, before you press analyze, you want to make sure that you've ticked the over-representation analysis button and not just the ID mapping and pathway assignment. Because the the default is just to see which of these maps to which pathway. Whereas the over-representation analysis is trying to find out if this list of identifiers is overly concentrated in one particular pathway or not, more than you would expect by just providing a random list of identifiers. And when you do that, you'll get back this list here of the most statistically overrepresented pathways in the list of identifiers you've provided. So the list of identifiers you've provided are overrepresented in the cell cycle, gene expression, DNA replication, signaling by NGS, apoptosis, DNA repair. Whereas they're not particularly overrepresented in transmembrane transport of small molecules. So this is the kind of top level pathway, but obviously some pathways will have more and more detail as you go down into them. And you should be aware that this does have importance to the overall ranking of the hits. So you can, as with any of these, you can reveal the next level and find out if anything else is overrepresented within a sub-level. There's no limitation to the amount of sub-levels you can have in Reactil. So always be aware that you might want to drill down further because it might be a specific sub-pathway that's overrepresented, not just the entire pathway. And the statistical significance is represented by a key value. And it also tells you how many proteins in your list matched the number of proteins or identifiers that are in that pathway in total. So in this case, 137 of the list match out of a possible 294. And then there's the information about the matching identifiers, and you can provide, expand to get more information. So, exercise 6, go to pathway analysis, select the example data set, and make sure that you check the over-representation analysis before pressing analyze. Okay. And what you want to do is find out of this list of identifiers we're giving, what's the most significantly overrepresented top-level pathway, how many genes are in it, and how many are represented in the data set. And we want to look at a couple of other anomalies that seem to show up. So those last two questions are to do with the interpretation of the list. Okay, I will just go through this exercise with you because it should be quite quick. So going back to the Reactil homepage, interested in pathway analysis, and I said, take the example data, check the over-representation analysis, and then analyze. And then the results will come back. So, what is the most overrepresented pathway? Top level pathway, most overrepresented in this case, is gene expression. So it gives you an E value of 5 times 10 to the minus 29. It also asked how many genes are in this pathway and how many were represented in the data set. So by looking at just the line, it says there are 413 genes in the pathway, of which 174 are represented in that data set that we listed identifiers that I've got. Now, the other questions are to highlight a couple of other issues and how you interpret this, and some warnings about interpreting it. So the first of the questions was, if you take a look at this list, and you've got things in red as being highly statistically significant, things in blue being statistically insignificant, or not significant, and you go down the list, which is ranked in significance, you eventually come to things like HIV infection, chromosome maintenance, and hemostasis that are ranked in the listings higher than respiratory transport, which you wouldn't normally assume is correct. You would expect it to be all red, then orange, then green, and all the way down to blue. Now, the only way you can find out why this might be the case is if you actually expand upon this. So if I expand upon chromosome maintenance, you'll find that there's a sub-pathway called telomere maintenance. And if you expand a bit more, you'll find the extension of telomeres. If you expand a bit more, you'll find telomere C-strand, lagging strand synthesis. Now, this is a really highly overrepresented sub-pathway. So 19 identifiers in the list match a possible 22, which is why it's really significant. You wouldn't expect that by chance. The chromosome maintenance picks up this highly significant sub-pathway and brings it up the rankings, which is why this pale green top pathway is actually higher up the list than things you would expect to be the other way around. And it's just because this really overrepresented sub pathway brought the whole thing up a grade that it should have done. So just be aware that if the top level pathway is represented in red, then pretty safe. However, if you start looking into these, then these have been brought up by sub pathways being. So it lets you identify ones you need to dig into in more depth. And the last question was more about the interpretation of these results. So if you take a look at these, gene expression, cell cycle, DNA replication, signaling, transcription, apoptosis, DNA repair. Your biological instinct as to what these might be, it's not clear cut. Everyone will have a slightly different opinion as to the significance of these proteins and what they're involved in. But generally speaking, they all seem to be either increasing cell growth or cell division. They're all processes involved in that type of stage of the cell. So that's probably where you should be looking as to where these proteins are involved in. And at least it gives you clues as to what to do next. So you've got your list of proteins and you think it's involved in cell growth, cell division. You can then start to look in more detail as to exactly what they might do. And why the data set that you've picked happens to do that. Okay. So just before we go, coffee break. The next thing that we're going to look at is species comparison. So we've looked at pathway browser, we've looked at pathway analysis, we're now going to look at species comparison. So by clicking on species comparison, you get this page. And what it's asking you to do is you compare all human pathways with whichever one of these drop-downs you're interested in. And if, for example, you pick, say, the rat, as is in this case, you will get a table back showing all the pathways, and it gives you further information about other species, the proteins in the human, the number of proteins in the other species, and therefore the percentage of the human proteins that are found in the other species. here we've got 72 proteins in human, 70 proteins in mice, so there's only 93% of the pathways covered in that. Some will have zero, and some will be 100%, and variations in between. For each of these individual pathways, you can then view. And when you click on a view, you get a slightly different pathway browser, pathway viewer. In this case, the colour coding is the most important feature. So this is all pretty much the same. The navigation is exactly the same. It's just that anything that's boxed in yellow is found in human and or rat. Anything that's in blue is only found in the human. The things that are grey are deemed to be not relevant for a variety of different reasons. The things in black are complexes. The important thing about complexes is not every component of a complex will be found in both organisms. Not always. So if you actually right click on this black box, it will show, it will say display components of this complex. And when you do that, you get a pop-up box that looks like this, and you can see that there are six blue proteins in this complex, so six that are only found in human, and one that's found in both the rat and human. So what we're going to do, what I suggest is, I'll just start you off in this exercise and then we can have some tea and coffee, and then we'll go through the answers about 5 to 10 to, okay? So it gives you time to have a break, stretch your legs, and then come back and still do this exercise. So these questions here, when you've got the species comparison between human and rat, open particular pathway, the complement cascade, and then look at it and try to answer these questions. Just before I go on, I just wanted to say that the statistics here have very specific statements, and it comes from a hypergeometric test. So there's information there about the statistics that are used for doing this over-representation analysis. It's not adjusted, so it's not corrected for multiple testing, but if you do want to get the information that's come out, you can download the information as a table. So if you follow down through the image, you eventually get to some stats about it. So the total number of events assessed was just over 5,000. Number of matching events, so individual hypergeometric tests, was 1,900. And the number of genes matching to significant identifiers was 960. Now, this information is effectively in more detail here in a table at the bottom, and you can download the results by clicking on this link. It's a tabbed illuminated text file which you can then import to whichever spreadsheet that you wish. But it will give you the unadjusted probability by seeing that number of genes by chance, the number of genes in the queen that map to that reaction or pathway, the total number of genes involved in that pathway, and it gives you the reactome identifier of that event, that pathway reaction, whatever. So it lets you be, you can then use that identifier to go back to reactome and look in more detail about the pathway. It tells you the name of the event, so in this case it's a pathway which is gene expression, and then it gives you the identifiers that map to that event, so all the neutrons or microarray data that maps to it, the identifiers are tagged here. So at least you can take that data and say, okay, this is the ones that are of interest to us, and cross-reference amongst the table. Now right down the bottom of the table is an O image that we used to have. So the old diagram for reactome used to be like this. So it was called a colouring, each of the arrows here is a step in a pathway. And some of the pathways are obvious from their shape, what they do, others are not so obvious. And as the actome has become more complex, we have moved away from using this, and we now use the new image, the new pathway explorer interactive. That's it. But you can see here there's a little pathway in the middle that's red, which is overrepresented. And if you needed that image for any reason, there's a link to download the images, PDF, SVG, or PNG formats. And then there's more details at the bottom about the mapping of the different identifiers to the different reactions.
So,
back up to the top. Unfortunately, there's no way to export this as an image, which would be nice to have. You could expand them all, and then you could just take snapshots if you wanted. It's a very slow way of doing it. Okay, so that was just relating to getting the data that you've submitted and mapping all of your identifiers and getting details of which reactions and pathways in that way, and which ones are overrepresented statistically. So, say for example, you had, let's just having a discussion about this, and if you have a set of proteins from an experiment, and say you've got a couple thousand, you've got, say, 100 that are interesting because there is evidence that they're important for some reason, perhaps. Got transcriptomics data to say that they're over or overexpressed, you could then take your list, map them onto the pathways, and see if one particular pathway or a couple of pathways are overly represented by that overexpressed set versus the rest of the data that's in there. So there are ways and means of using that information. Okay, so in our exercise, we're looking at the species comparison. And we were going to compare human against rat. Okay. So when you do that, you will get a table of all the reactions, all the pathways, sorry, and table of how many of each are found in the rat. And in particular, we were looking at complement cascade. So if I just scroll down this table, you'll find complement cascade is here. So you see there's 17% are found in the rat, because there's 171 human proteins, but only 30 rat proteins. So we're wanting to look at this in more detail. So by zooming out, you get to see there's a number of blue proteins here, so these are the human-only ones, or identifiers, or aspects. There are some yellow ones, which are found in both. And there are quite a lot of black boxes here, which are complexes. So it's asking to find complement factor B, which in this case is actually found in the bottom left-hand side, bottom left-hand corner of. So complement factor B is a yellow box, which means that it's been inferred to exist in black. Now you could click on that and this should expand to let you see where it lies. That's what that reaction is. The next question was, what other species is that protein inferred to be present in? You don't have to go back to do this, you can just get the answer by looking at the details. So by opening up the details tab at the bottom, there's a section that says entities deduced on the basis of this entity. Okay, so here's where this has been inferred in other organisms. So you've got dog, bull, cow, mouse. So there's a number of events there. So it's saying here as well, the next question is, find complement factor 2 in the top middle. Go up to the top middle. There's complement factor 2, and it's a blue box. And that means that it's not been inferred to exist in rats. C3B in top left hand corner. Here is the black box, and that's because it's a complex. So how many proteins contribute to this, and are they predicted to exist in rat? So by right clicking on the black box, you get display participating molecules, and if you do that, you see that this these two here. So these two are human only, so there's nothing being inferred to rat within that complex. And the final question was asking, why is calcium gray? So calcium is gray because it's a small molecule. So there's no point in doing a species comparison in something that's a generic, ubiquitous, small molecule. Because it doesn't matter if you're a rat, or a human, or a plant, or a bug, calcium is calcium. So if it's present, it's there, if it's present, it's not. So it doesn't matter about the colour in this case. Okay. So that was species comparison. And now we're going to go on to expression analysis. So this is an opportunity to map expression data onto pathways. And it gives you the option there on the top page and the home page is for expression analysis. If you go there, it's another table that's very similar to the pathway analysis, except you're uploading slightly different data. So if you upload the example data, you'll see this. This is a microarray experiment where you've got a number of measurements taken at different times in the course of the experiment. So you've got 10-hour data control, you've got the 10-hour study data, you've got 14-hour, 18-hour, and 24-hour. And all it's doing here is we've got the probe set number. So the identifier here is the probe set identifier. You've then got a space, which gives you the control, then the 10-hour value, then 14, then 18, then 24. So this is just space delimitation. And what it will do is it will take that data, it understands the fact that there should be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 columns of data for each identifier. And you can upload your wish. And when you press analyze, you'll get the same table of results back. So it tells you the expression per pathway. And if you view in more detail a particular pathway or a particular subpathway, it does a similar thing. It displays the pathway diagram, but in this case the colouring is based purely on the over or under expression level, and it does that based on your minimum and maximum values within the data set. So in this case the minimum value for that particular set of data was 3.86, the maximum is 10.92, and it does a colouring scale in between. The hot is the high expression and the cold is the low expression. It also, if you remember, the complexes are black boxes, but if you expand the black box, you see each component is coloured by the expression value. And particularly if you have multiple columns of data, you will get a bar appearing at the bottom that lets you navigate from one step to the next. So you can have, this will show you the data at the control level. By pressing forward, you'll go to the experimental 10-hour level. Going forward, you'll go to the 14, 18, 24. So you can actually start to see the expression of particular aspects within a pathway changing over time. So it's a nice visualizer for this. So the best way to see how it works is to use it. So if you go on to the site, launch the expression analysis, and load the example data set in the same way as we did with the pathway analysis. Click analyze, and then when the results come back, we're looking particularly at the nucleotide excision repair pathway. So you get that table of results, go there, and then take a look at some of these questions and see. I'll give you a bit more time on that because it's quite involved. There's a lot of navigating around. So the last thing that I want to show really, this last of the features in Reactome, is the molecular interaction overlay. And effectively this comes around because we can integrate the data in-house, make links between Reactome and Intact and various other databases. And so for any given reaction or object, in particular objects, you can select the object, and if you right click on it, you'll get display interactors or export interactors. And if you display the interactors, it will produce a spike diagram of all the protein entries that are known to be interact with this one of the. So you can see some of these become quite complicated as you expand more and more. So in this case, there's a box here that indicates that there are 6 proteins. Sometimes the box will say 50 plus or even more. But it won't obviously draw them all on, it'll just list them. If you want more details, you need to go into this Analyze, Annotate and Upload link. And for that, it will tell you you can change the colouring of this, you can set a confidence level for the thresholds, you can switch off colouring, you can clear the overlay. So if you've clicked on a few things and it's all a bit messy, you can clear all of it by clicking there. And more importantly, you can display a table of all the interactors for that pathway. And you can also export all the interactors. So, let's see if we can get this exercise working, because it should be a less of a load on the server. What we're going to do is open up a pathway diagram for Netrune 1 signaling. So do a search for that on the Reactome homepage. Open up the pathway diagram, and then find protein SHP2 in the top left, cytosol. Right click and display the interactor. signaling pathway. And interested in protein SHP2. So by right-clicking, you get an option of displaying interactors or exporting interactors. I just wanted to quickly display interactors as well. Do it. And this is taking information from intact. Okay. So when you do that, and it runs, it will come back with 6 interactors. I need to think about it for a minute. Now, for any of you that have managed to get into it, then it's behaving for you. If you click on any of the lines between the central node and any of the interactors, it will take you through to intact database itself. And that's where you can find out the information about the associated PubMed IDs and how many of the interactions that are listed are actually from the same experiment or not. So in the example that we asked you to have a look at, it's saying how many interactors are there, and it's asking how many times is the interaction between SHP2 and one of the 6 GRB2 associated binder being documented. So that information comes from intact, and if you go to the intact page and for that interaction, the interaction is identified 3 times. So in the table of results, there's 3 entries. However, there's only 1 corresponding paper for all 3. And the reason behind this is, in the paper, there are 3 different types of evidence for that interaction. So it's actually only really 1 interaction because of 1 paper, but there's more than 1 more than one source of evidence for that interaction. Okay. Okay. If you do the same for SRC, which is another protein here, which is also not doing for me, in this time you'll get a lot more, but in the center it says 50 plus. And that's because there's a lot more interactors in this case than can be sensibly displayed on this diagram. So, to actually analyze it and to find out the list of those entries, you would need to use this analyze, annotate, and upload link. Incidentally, I've emailed the Reactome team to see if they can find out what's happening with the server, because they should be in work shortly, so they should be able to respond. And then they ask you to have a look at UNC5B down at the bottom of the page, this one here. And if you do that, display interactors or display participating interactions, you don't get anything back, and that's because it doesn't have any interactors. Okay, so that's why that question's in there. And what's the easiest way to move them all? Once again, it's in the analyze, annotate, and upload. And there's the clear display interaction display. So by doing that, you'll remove all of these additional tags that we can put on. So my apologies, that's not seeming to work very well, and hopefully it should be biomarker feed because you've already did one with Ensemble. That'll just show you it's very similar. They have the biomarker link from the Reactome homepage. I think you have to go into tools. You get a similar view to what you would expect from Biomark when you used it with Ensemble. They have their own canned queries. So for specific regularly asked questions, you can just use one of those. And that's what's going to, it'll ask you for some inputs and then you can use that process. Or you could build your own query. Now in this case, you'd be choosing the Reactome database, and then you'd be looking at perhaps reactions or pathways or complexes. Now, as before, the way Biomark works is the same throughout, irrespective of the database you use. So you apply various filters, and the filters, if you click on them, it gives you a variety of ones. So you can limit to reactions containing specific identifiers, you can limit to species, you can limit to a variety of other aspects. And the attributes is how do you want the data to be displayed. So the attributes are give me the reaction identifier, check this if you want the species name as well, and you can tailor the output of the biomark query to exactly the information that you're looking for, and ignoring everything else. So the results that you get back are effectively a table on a page, as you wished, with the appropriate columns that you wish to be displayed. You can export all the results as a file, or export just the unique results, because some queries will pull out the same identifier multiple times if it matches all of those parameters. And you can export it as a variety of different formats of file. If it's a large file, it might be an idea to put your email address in, and then it will let you know that the file is ready. But apart from that, I don't think we will do this, because if the main site's not working, then I doubt very much the file. If anyone wants to try it, be more than welcome. But what I might do is stop the Reactome session there. Say thank you very much for that.